a judicial appointments commission, which is firstly a full-time body. Today, one of the reasons why this arbitrary ad hoc appointment process goes on is because you have an ex officio body of sitting judges. They are very busy with their judicial work. They do not have any time to devote to a proper rational system of selecting judges, because if you want to do it in a rational manner, then it's a time-consuming job. You have to see who are the potential people who could be appointed. You have to examine their records on some criteria. You have to first frame a criteria. This is what I will be. If today you ask any Chief Justice or retired Chief Justice, sir, what do you see when you select a judge? What are the qualities that you see? Or what are the qualities that you are looking for in selecting judges? I can guarantee that virtually all of them, without exception, will say, we look at competence and we look at integrity. We looked at whether, will you not also see whether this man has any understanding of the basic problems of the people of this country? Today, a lot of the judges who are being appointed are basically corporate lawyers who have no understanding of the problems of the common people of this country. So, is that not a relevant criteria for selecting judges? Is it not necessary to lay down a criteria for selecting judges and to decide how you would evaluate people on the basis of that criteria? And you need to have a body which has time to evaluate people on that criteria. If you have sitting judges who are already overburdened with work, then this is what will happen. This is what has been happening. And this is what will continue to happen in the new Judicial Appointments Committee, because at least 4 out of these 6 people are ex-officio people who are very busy. The law minister is also a very busy person. So therefore, he cannot spend enough time on these issues. And now the issue of accountability of the judiciary. Unfortunately, while the Constitution laid great emphasis on independence of the judiciary, equal emphasis was not given on the accountability of judges in the country, with the result that the only accountability that we have under the Constitution is removal by impeachment. And this, we have seen, is an exceedingly difficult and cumbersome process. Even in order to initiate impeachment of a judge, you require signatures of 100 Lok Sabha MPs or 50 Raj Sabha MPs. Now, most political parties have cases going on in courts, and they are very reluctant to sign an impeachment motion, especially against a Supreme Court, sitting Supreme Court judge, or against even a very powerful Chief Justice of a High Court. It's exceedingly difficult to persuade enough MPs to sign impeachment motions. It has only happened 3 times so far. V. Ramaswamy, where enough MPs signed the impeachment motion, thereafter there is a inquiry by a judge's inquiry committee. They held him guilty on several counts. Thereafter, the motion goes into parliament. And there, unfortunately, it fell, because you require not only a majority of the people voting, you require an absolute majority of the total membership of the House. And in that case, though it was unanimously passed in the Lok Sabha, but because the Congress party abstained, it did not have the support of an absolute majority of the total membership of the Lok Sabha, and therefore it fell. In the case of Justice Dinakaran, again the inquiry committee held him guilty, then he resigned. In the case of Justice Soumitra Sen, again the inquiry committee held him guilty and he, or was going to hold him guilty and he resigned. But these are only three out of very large number of, huge number of corrupt judges who needed, who should have been impeached, but who could not be impeached. We had prepared impeachment motions against two former Supreme Court judges, which we had tried to get signed. We got them signed by about half the requisite number of MPs after a great deal of effort, though there was very, very strong documentary evidence warranting their impeachment against Justice Punchi and Justice Anand. But we could not get the requisite number of signatures because of this fear among political parties that, look, they will be victimized in their cases in the judiciary if they sign impeachment motions against powerful people. So we have seen that this is a very, very difficult process, and this has resulted in a fair degree of impunity amongst judges of the higher judiciary, because they feel that it is virtually impossible for anybody to do anything against them. And that is why we have been seeing brazen, I mean, just the other day I had to send a complaint, day before yesterday, against the present or the new person who has been appointed as the chairman of the Press Council of India, Justice C.K. Prasad, who was a judge of the Supreme Court, against whom a totally shocking and brazen case erupted, where he called up a case which was pending before another bench. So what happened was, there was a case listed before him. In that case, he passed an order saying that list this case along with another case. That case was not even before his bench. That was a case pending before another bench of the Supreme Court. That case had no connection with this case. Yet he called that case and got it connected. Next time when the case came up, the lawyers pointed out that this has no connection with that case. So he passed an order saying, all right, this may be disconnected from that case, and yet proceeded to deal with that case on the same day and passed an order allowing the appeal on the basis of a compromise. This involves a property worth thousands of crores in Pune, which compromise had already been rejected earlier by the Supreme Court. And it turned out that this company belonged to the in-laws of his junior, and the lawyer who appeared for this company is the chambermaid of his son. And he did this so brazenly, and yet he has been appointed chairman of the Press Council. What I am saying is, Mr. Dushyant Dave, a senior advocate of the Supreme Court, wrote a very scathing letter detailing these facts, annexing all the evidence to the Chief Justice of India. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. Because nobody wants to touch a judge of the Supreme Court, least of all the judiciary. We had filed a petition in the Supreme Court. We had sent a letter against the former Chief Justice, Justice Balakrishnan, who is the chairman of the National Human Rights Commission, saying that, pointing out that he has acquired 35 properties in the name of his son, son-in-law, his brother, and so on, which are totally disproportionate to his known sources of income, that he has lied, there were four serious charges against him. That complaint was made to the government that, look, remove him from this position. Unfortunately, it suits every government to have such weak, corrupt or pliable people in such watchdog institutions like NHRC or CBI chief or whatever. Because no, every government feels ki look, if such a person is there, he will not hold anybody accountable. I mean, he will not perform his role as a watchdog. So they appointed this gentleman. Everybody knew that he was corrupt. Everybody. You will not even come across a single lawyer in the Supreme Court who will have anything good to say about him. But yet he was appointed chairman of NHRC, and when we went to the government with documentary evidence against him, that under the Human Rights Protection of Human Rights Act, you have to refer this complaint to the Supreme Court for inquiry. Please refer this to the Supreme Court for inquiry. Here is documentary evidence of his buying 35 properties in the names of his immediate relatives who can't explain these properties from their own income. Nothing was done. We went to the Supreme Court to challenge the government's inaction, and the Supreme Court also did nothing. Because we have seen that even honest judges, unfortunately, by and large, protect their own. And they don't deal with corruption among their own brethren. And that is why we have been saying that you need a completely independent judicial conduct commission, which is independent of the government and independent of the judiciary, which can independently, and that should be also a full-time body, which should be able to examine allegations of corruption or misconduct against judges, independently investigate them, get them investigated, and then if they find that the judge is guilty of misconduct, of any kind of misconduct, then they should recommend his removal and he should be automatically removed without the matter going into parliament for voting. But nothing of that kind has been done. Instead of that, a judicial standards and accountability bill was brought, which provided that there will be a judicial oversight committee. This judicial oversight committee will consist of the Chief Justice, a former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, few other jurists to be appointed by the government. Who else was there in that? A 4-5 member committee, which was going to be selected essentially by the government or the sitting Chief Justice. So it was neither going to be independent of the judiciary nor of the government. Then it said that there will be a scrutiny committee, that if a complaint is made against a High Court judge, then there will be a scrutiny committee consisting of two sitting judges of that same High Court plus a retired Chief Justice of that same High Court to scrutinize the complaint against that judge. Now, do we expect sitting judges to be able to fairly inquire into the complaint against their own brother judges with whom they are sitting day in and day out, at home, in the office, in the court, everywhere? It's a clear conflict of interest. And we have been seeing this conflict of interest operate throughout. And yet, it said that all proceedings before this inquiry, before the scrutiny committee, and if the scrutiny committee finds anything against the judge, then an investigation committee will be set up, and then that investigation committee will go into all this. That investigation committee will be set up by the oversight committee. And the proceedings of this scrutiny committee or investigation committee will be totally in camera. If anybody writes anything about this, he will be sent to jail. If any complaint is found to be frivolous, he will be sent to jail. Who the hell is going to send any complaint to this kind of committee, which is totally fixed by you have sitting judges who are sitting with the same judge against whom you have complained day in and day out, at home, in office, and you expect me to take my complaint to that very body and expect them to independently and fairly inquire into that complaint. So, absolutely bogus bill was brought, and fortunately it has not been made into law. But the point is that today we have a system where we do not have any credible system of inquiring into complaints against judges. But apart from that, there are other problems that have come up regarding accountability of judges. The Supreme Court in Veera Swami's case, Veera Swami was this Chief Justice of Chennai, I think, of Madras High Court. Chief Justice of some High Court against whom cash was found in a raid at his house. And the question arose, cash which he couldn't explain. And he took the view that judges are outside the purview of the Prevention of Corruption Act. Supreme Court rejected that view, fortunately, but went on to say that in order to protect the independence of the judiciary, you cannot register an FIR against a judge unless you have got the written permission of the Chief Justice of India. Now, we wrote to the former Chief Justice, Justice Sabharwal, for his permission to register FIRs against two judges of the High Courts, one from the Delhi High Court, one from the Allahabad High Court, against whom we had documentary evidence of corruption. But no permission was given. It was, no response was given. It was just thrown in the waste paper basket. Till date, no permission has ever been given by the judiciary for investigating a sitting judge of any high court. Except perhaps this one case in Chandigarh. In Chandigarh, that was a very, very gross case. In that case, perhaps that's the only solitary case where permission has been given. So this has added a further measure of protection to corrupt judges, that you cannot even be subjected to any investigation, because unless you get the permission of the Chief Justice of India, you will not be investigated. The third problem is that contempt. Well, you can't remove a judge, you can't get him investigated for corruption, but at least you can expose him by writing about it. But if you write about it, you run the risk of contempt. And though I have written about these matters and I have also faced contempt, etc., but by and large, you see, people do not, and the media also does not want to take the risk of writing against, they are afraid to even write against retired judges. Even my letter to the Prime Minister against the appointment of Justice C.K. Prashad, who is a retired judge now, as the Press Council Chairman, has hardly been carried by the media because of the fear of contempt. So therefore, you cannot even expose a corrupt judge because of this fear of contempt. Though today the law has been amended and truth has been, earlier of course the Supreme Court said truth is no defense to contempt. If you are facing contempt, and even if what you have said is true, you still go to jail. If you have brought the judiciary or a judge into disrepute, and even if you have truthfully said what he has done, you still go to jail. But now with this amendment in the Contempt of Courts Act, truth has been made into a defense. But even then, you'll have to establish the truth before the same judges or their brother judges. Who wants to risk that? Therefore, that is why there is very little exposure or public exposure or media exposure of corruption in the judiciary, which is extensive. It's extensive. I won't say that it is as much as in the executive, but it is very substantial, but it remains hidden because of this. They say that, look, it's necessary, the judiciary says it's necessary to keep it hidden to preserve public confidence in the judiciary. How will you clean up the judiciary unless you expose all these things to the public gaze? Only then will reforms come about. If you just keep it hidden, it means that you are just allowing this problem to fester. The fourth problem is their insulation from the Right to Information Act. Now, under the Right to Information Act, the judiciary is also a public authority, and therefore information about the judiciary should be accessible from the judiciary. But in virtually every case where information was sought, even about whether it was about appointment of judges, whether it was about judgments which remain pending, which are not delivered. Somebody asked this question, ki, look, how many judgments are pending and for how long? Everything is stonewalled. Why? Even when the Central Information Commission orders the judiciary to give this information, the judiciary itself files a writ petition against in its own courts and gets it stayed. And therefore, they are judges in their own cause, and unfortunately, they have virtually stayed every order allowing the right to information against the judiciary. So, we have these whole host of problems. We need to solve them. This country needs extensive and comprehensive judicial reforms. Judicial reforms in order to make the judiciary accessible to the people who cannot afford lawyers. If we do away with much of these procedures, if we just simplify the court system and have some kind of paralegal help for these litigants, then the judiciary can be made accessible. There was this proposal of these Gram Nyayalayas. There is an act also, Gram Nyayalaya Act. Earlier the proposal was that these would be kind of informal courts where CPC etc., Evidence Act etc. need not apply, and they can formulate their own procedure which will enable even ordinary people to approach these courts. But ultimately even CPC was applied, Evidence Act was applied, and therefore again it has become similar to other courts, which means that you cannot access them without lawyers. You need fast tracking of cases, for which you need firstly more competent judges, more judges, more courts, more competent judges. Now, more competent judges would require a robust, transparent and credible appointments, commission and selection system. We have not put that in place. We are going ahead with that same old system of a non-transparent system of appointing judges, with the result that a lot of the judges who are being appointed are not of adequate quality. And then we need, of course, proper accountability, for which we need a Judicial Conduct Commission, we need a Judicial Appointments Commission to select judges in a proper, credible manner. We need a Judicial Conduct Commission to take care of complaints against the judges in an independent, credible manner. So all these reforms are required. I am just mentioning them broadly. But the question is, who will do it? We have a case pending in the Supreme Court for the last 8 years on judicial reforms, filed by Common Cause and the Forum for Fast Justice. Of course, the first case that we filed on this was dismissed summarily by a judge of the Supreme Court on the ground that, how have you impleaded the Chief Justice of India? I said that, look, judicial reforms require push by both the government as well as the Chief Justice of India. That's why I've implicated him. If you want, I'll delete him. He dismissed the case just on this ground. They have passed orders and PILs relating to police reforms, electoral reforms, various reforms, etc. But virtually no effective orders have been passed on judicial reforms. Government is not interested in judicial reforms because it suits the government to have a non-functional or dysfunctional judiciary. Because a functional, credible, robust judiciary will hold the government to account more robustly, will enforce the fundamental rights of the people more robustly. But that's not what they want. So it suits them to have a collapsed judiciary or a dysfunctional judiciary. And unfortunately, it also suits the existing judiciary to have a collapsed and dysfunctional judiciary. Why? Today, arbitration is one of the most lucrative industries for retired judges. It's an industry in which retired judges are making crores a year, 10 times, 20 times of the kind of income that they used to have as judges, they are making as retired judges by way of arbitration. They charge 2 lakhs a day, sometimes 5 lakhs a day for arbitration. This industry is flourishing only because the existing judiciary is dysfunctional. And therefore, the day you make the existing judiciary properly functional, this whole arbitration industry will collapse. And therefore, unfortunately, the existing judiciary has also started feeling comfortable in this present system of a dysfunctional judiciary. It suits them to have a dysfunctional judiciary. So who will bell the cat? Who will do this? For this, we really need a push by the real stakeholders in the administration of justice, and that is the consumers of justice. That is citizens like you and me, who need a functional, robust, credible judicial system to enforce our rights, to get our disputes resolved swiftly, credibly, honestly. So unless there is a movement of citizens, of the real stakeholders in justice in this country, we are not likely to see any credible judicial reforms in this country. Thank you very much.
Say wonderful lecture when we have invited you, but as I mentioned in my introduction, I think Prashant has shown a lot of courage to insist on judicial probity and probity in judicial life, and that sentiment came out in this lecture. And while we hear a lot of people talk about judicial independence, there are very few people who have given thought as to what should constitute this new form of judicial independence and what needs to be done. And that, I thought, came out very clearly in Prashant's lecture. So we have about 15-20 minutes. We can take some questions. We'll take maybe 2 to 3 questions at a time, and then let Prashant answer. Yes?
Grounds of how you ask, and the basis of how you measure the competence of a judge based on his elevation. The US has a very interesting procedure on measuring this competence. Before the judges appear before the Senate for their interviews, there's an independent organization that passes an evaluation just the way the Dutch does to their MLAs, marking them on a scale of 5 or scale of 10 based on judicial reasoning. You considering what's happening in India, there's hardly any analysis done of judicial reasoning. The High Court judgments which have passed, hardly any evaluation is done. For example, the recent judges who've been elevated to the Supreme Court, Is there any organization or anywhere you find a mention of the appreciability or at least their quality of the judges that delivered in the law court? You believe it is a good reason, a good suggestion to start off on a large note that when the NJSC comes into force, hoping it does, you could pass on these suggestions to the members and probably hope for more competent judges.
Bodies, both in terms of appointments as well as in terms of monitoring judges. Could you tell us a bit more about how you would constitute these independent bodies or constitute these bodies such that they are independent? And if you could address your answer to whether you would then require any sort of political representation at all on these bodies.
Thank you, Mr. Bhushan, for your enlightening lecture. Yeah. Don't you think the need of the hour to reduce the litigation level throughout the country is to have high court benches in all the four zones within the state as well as Supreme Court benches throughout the four zones in the country, so that it's going to Supreme Court for a common man is a costly affair. Half of the judgments of the High Court don't land in appeal from Supreme Court because of the costly affair in the litigation litigants.